My name is Chloe Cole, and I am a detransitioner, and this caused me lifelong, irreversible harm. I speak to you today as a victim of one of the biggest medical scandals in the history of the United States of America. Medical professionals immediately set our entire family down a path of ideologically motivated deceit and coercion. They asked my parents a simple question. Would you rather have a dead daughter or a living transgender son? I feel like a monster. I had a double mastectomy at 15. I will never be able to breastfeed. And I have massive scars across my chest. My nipples are weeping fluid today. Everything that I went through did nothing to address my underlying mental health issues that I had. The drugs and surgeries changed my body, but they did not and could not change the basic reality that I am and forever will be a female. I wasn't suicidal. After my surgery, I did become suicidal. I didn't need to be lied to. I needed to be given therapy to help me work through my issues, not affirmed to my delusion that by transforming into a boy, it would solve all my problems. We need to stop telling 12-year-olds that they were born wrong. My childhood was ruined, along with thousands of detransitioners that I know through our networks. This needs to stop.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's episode of the Dr. J Show. My guest today is Miss Chloe Cole, who is a passionate and articulate and poised 19-year-old young woman who passionately advocates against the practice of transitioning minors. Chloe embarked on her own transition journey when she was only 12 years old, only to subsequently try to detransition at 16. She speaks with firsthand authority about the problems associated with the attempts to change the sex of the body. Chloe, welcome to the Dr. J Show. It's an honor and privilege to have you on the show.
Thank you so much for having me.
We saw your testimony in front of the House Judiciary Committee a few days ago, and you did so well. I was very impressed with your poise and your talk, your 5-minute talk, whatever it was that the limit they gave you was 5 minutes?
Around there, yeah.
Yeah. It's hard to get it all in 5 minutes, isn't it? You know, that's a real.
Yeah. At hearings like that, it's pretty difficult to get your piece in, especially like during the questioning.
Yes. Well, and your response to the mother was also very powerful, I thought. And that was completely extemporaneous, right? Of course, there was no way you could prepare that. So that was very impressive.
Thank you.
Mrs. Reynolds.
And you can direct it to me and say that what Ms. Reynolds talked about, you want to respond to. And you go ahead.
Well, I understood that Mrs. Reynolds is scared for her child. And I just want to set the record straight that I don't hate her. I don't think anybody in this room hates her. In fact, I see my own mother and my own father in her, and that she dearly loves her child. And she's doing the best with what she's been given. And unfortunately, it's not much. And for that, I'm sorry. I mean, I think every parent deserves the utmost grace and guidance with how to help their child. That being said, I don't wish for her child to have the same result as I did. I don't wish for anybody to regret transition or to detransition because it's incredibly difficult. It comes with its own difficulties, and it's not easy. And I hope that her child gets to have a happy and fulfilling adulthood.
I think now the people who follow the Ruth Institute are generally familiar with the kind of the big picture of the issues surrounding transgenderism. And I think what would be really helpful is for people to get an idea of what it's really like, you know, what the reality of it is for you as a person, for your family and so on. And so if you could just share with us, what is it that made you think you were a boy? What was going through Chloe's mind? What was happening in your life? What made you think you were a boy?
It was mainly related to like my body, the way that I looked and the way that I liked presenting myself and my personality. I always thought that there was something different about me, and I found it kind of hard to relate to my peers at times. And as I got older, like the divide between me and the other girls my age just got bigger and bigger. And I wondered for years what that was. Now I think I mostly understand it to be related to having an undiagnosed case of autism. I was previously, and I believe erroneously, diagnosed with ADHD. I felt like it didn't really understand why socially, it didn't really explain why socially I wasn't very, didn't really fit in with my peers. Mm-hmm. And why I thought or acted the way that I was. And especially as I got older and started to like hit puberty, I felt like I related to boys more. I felt like I was more of a tomboy. I started to reject wearing things like just like more feminine clothing and presenting myself more femininely. I used to be like a super stereotypical like girly kid. Like I loved like Barbies, Bratz dolls, Monster High dolls. When I loved playing dress up and whenever my older sisters would put makeup on me. But as I got older, I kind of just fell into a more tomboyish phase, I guess you could say. But it wasn't until I started to like hit puberty that I started to really even think about like being female and what that meant, and the mm-hmm. fact that I was growing from a girl into a woman and how uncomfortable that was for me. And I had like a fairly early puberty. I hit puberty at around like 9 years old. So I was developing a little bit earlier than my peers. Yeah.
And so, hold on. Let me just question you on that. So that people understand, for you, what was it that was happening at nine o'clock? What was happening at 9 years old that seemed premature?
Well, my breasts started to come in. Uh-huh. And so did the way that I started to have like feelings for people of the opposite sex, and sometimes even people of like the same sex, but generally it was uh-huh. boys. Uh-huh. This didn't really bother me too much, but this new attention to like my chest and like the other like developing parts of my body was really complicated for me. It was very uncomfortable a lot of the time. I would get kind of unwarranted comments on like my chest or my butt from like sometimes like classmates, sometimes like adults even. And while it felt kind of nice to at times to like at least have some sort of attention, it felt like I had some worth. It was also not exactly what I wanted to be recognized for.
Right. Especially at the age of 9 or 10 or 11.
Right.
That kind of attention was not what you were psychologically ready for.
No, not at all. I mean,
right.
It felt like I was really being like thrust into adulthood almost, but I was still a kid.
Yes. And that's true. You were. Your body was your body was thrusting you there, but of course you weren't ready.
It was ahead of my mind in some ways.
Right.
I had been bullied throughout a lot of my childhood as well. Throughout like early elementary school, like maybe like first to third grade. And then once I moved schools, I was back at square one, and in middle school I was kind of an outcast as well. People would often make comments on like my appearance, or like sometimes like even the things that made me super feminine when I was younger, I started to become very insecure about. I felt like it was kind of ridiculous to be so girly, or that like I was ugly. And the things I would hear about like being a woman, about like female puberty, and like going through like the development of your body, having like all these eyes on you, and knowing that like people can like see the shape of you, and also just like the experience of like going through periods, how like the possibility of pregnancy, and like how difficult pregnancy and childbirth is, and have like all these social expectations. It was a lot for me, and I almost never really heard about the things that made it great, which all of these things, they're really a blessing, but nobody really emphasized that to me. I would always hear about how painful it was, and I would always think like, how would I want to have any part of that? I don't want to do that. I don't want to bleed every month. I don't want to like have this intimate part of my body like almost like ripped apart to give birth to another human being. It was scary for me to hear about, which I feel like was a pretty natural reaction, really.
Yes. And so were you in dialogue with your mom and maybe your older sisters about this type of stuff?
So I'm the youngest kid of of about five kids, and my siblings are all a lot older than me by like 7 to 8 years almost. And everybody was pretty much all moved out of the house by the time that I was having all these concerns. And I wouldn't say that I felt like I had a close enough relationship with my mom to really talk about stuff like that. Not because we had a bad relationship or anything, but we just were not particularly intimate. And stuff like that was kind of embarrassing for me to talk about anyways.
So when you're having all this unwanted attention, say ages 9 through 12, something like that, you're getting all this unwanted attention. Did anyone talk with you about the fact that this was a little premature and maybe they could assist you in some ways medically with that? Did that conversation come up with anyone?
No, it wasn't really like a like pathologized or anything. But sometimes like my own family members would make comments on it, not like in like a gross way, but they were kind of shocked by how early my puberty was. And sometimes it would like just kind of like embarrass me, like talking about like, oh, she's old enough to wear bras, or like, wow, you're growing so tall. Just like it, just stuff that like I didn't really want to hear.
Well, the reason I ask is that we have a friend who's a pediatric endocrinologist, Dr. Quentin Van Meter, and he explained to me at one point that the actual legitimate use for a puberty blocker isn't a case where you've got seriously premature onset of puberty and you use it to delay puberty until the child has aged to where puberty would be more natural, you know, so that the social and the physical would be a little bit better aligned. Yeah, and then you turn it back on. You know, it's not meant to be permanent at that point. He described it as a six-year-old boy who had testosterone levels of an adult, you know, and what kind of a chaos that would be, you know, for a six-year-old with no breaks, you know, with the male level, adult male levels of testosterone. But this wasn't on anybody's radar for you, it sounds like.
No, and I don't think I was young enough to like to qualify for like an actual clinical case of premature puberty.
You were at the young end of normal,
right?
And and so you mentioned that you got a diagnosis of ADHD, and then you also had a some kind of autism on the spectrum type of diagnosis. How old were you when you got those diagnoses?
I was about 8 when I think when I was diagnosed with ADHD. And then I was subsequently medicated for it at like 10 or 11 after my grades started dropping, after I started moving schools. And I haven't gotten like an official autism diagnosis, unfortunately. I've had multiple screenings throughout my life, and each time my mom and dad and I were basically told that I was too like smart and too well-spoken to even possibly be on the spectrum, even though most people who are on the high functioning end of it tend to be a little bit more intelligent than average.
Well, you know, you're one of those kids who has some unusual characteristics and nobody could find a box for you.
Right.
So you were struggling. Yeah, you were struggling and trying to manage, and your family's trying to help and so on. And so at some point you decided you were a boy. Were there other influences that pointed you in that particular direction?
Yeah, it wasn't until I hit about 12 years old that I started to actually like question my gender and my identity related to that. And I started to feel as though like I was just too ugly and too boyish to even be a girl. Like all the other girls my age were starting to get like really like curvier bodies and like bigger hips and breasts and stuff. And like I was a little bit on the skinnier, slightly more athletic side, and I didn't really have like a defined waist or hips or breasts or anything like that. I mean, I felt like relatively comparing myself to my peers and like some of my family members and the stuff that I would see on like social media, I would think like, why don't I have like an hourglass body? Why aren't I like thick or curvy? I don't look how women are supposed to look. I had a little bit more muscle and I had a little bit more, my shoulders were like a little bit stronger and I had like stronger legs than the other girls in my grade, and people would often make comments on that. And I felt like because of what I perceived to be a more boyish body, mm-hmm. and a more masculine presentation, I didn't like wearing like girls' clothes or having long hair. I sometimes questioned why I was even born as a girl, and I felt like in a lot of ways my life would be better if I was a boy. But mm-hmm. I didn't really get the idea that I was actually a boy until I was introduced to the transgender community through Instagram.
Oh, okay. Well, I want to just pause and tell you that when I was that age that you're describing, I had this question. It wasn't so much that I questioned whether I was a girl or a boy. It was just like, God, the boys look like they're having more fun. Can I hang out with you guys? And, you know, and one of my sisters refused to wear anything except a sailor dress, you know, that had a little sailor collar on it because she, you know, was a little bit more tomboyish and stuff like that. And, you know, so, okay, these things, you think these things and you wonder these things, but, you know, we pass through that without too much trauma. So for you, it was encountering the trans community on Instagram that put the thought in your mind that maybe you really truly were not a girl at all. You were not a girl with a rough puberty or a girl with questions about her body, that you were really truly a boy. Tell us a little bit about what that was like. What happened? What did you see? What did people do? Just tell us about that.
I mean, I didn't find it right away. I made my first social media at around like the ages of 11 to 12. Because that's what everybody else my age was using, right? I wanted to see what I was missing out on. So I made like Instagram and Snapchat accounts, and I would add some of my friends from school on there. And I would also kind of just browse it for hours because I was just seeing a lot of interesting stuff on there. And I was mostly browsing stuff that was like related to my personal interests, like video games and stuff. And a lot of the users in the communities around my interests were like trans identified females and young people who identified as like a part of the LGBT. And sometimes these people would make posts about their own personal lives. And I started seeing more and more posts that were just focused on like the LGBT in general. And it was just really interesting to me because a lot of what these people would say about how like they were brought up or their childhoods or the way that they felt about themselves, their bodies and stuff really deeply resonated with me. It kind of, I don't know, it started to make me wonder like, well, what does this mean for me? Like, why am I so drawn to this? And the way it was all presented was, I mean, generally it was pretty bright and cheery, like all of these colorful flags and all these cute drawings and the sense of community that these people seem to have. And also like sometimes they would talk about like the hardships they would go through and how painful it was, but it was always about like how painful gender dysphoria was, and then finally getting treatment, like going on testosterone or cross-sex hormones or otherwise, how happy it made them feel and how it resolved those feelings, and finding that sense of community amongst other people who are like them after like having like coming from like abusive homes or neglect or being in the foster care system, or having been bullied at school. And it was just, it was kind of touching to me. So, I mean, with having been exposed to it for a little while, naturally I started to think, well, maybe I'm a part of these people. Maybe mm-hmm. that's why I relate to them so much. It started with questioning my sexuality, because sometimes I did have crushes on other girls my age, or like girls in shows that I would watch. But I mean, I didn't really care about stuff like that. And I was still mostly attracted to boys, really. And then I started to think about my gender and what that meant for me, because, you know, I was starting to feel more boyish and not really want to be very, very girly at all, which I think was just like a natural part of growing up for me at the time. Mm-hmm. But it seemed very profound to me. And I started to think, well, maybe I'm not entirely female. Maybe I'm somewhere in between. But I started to question what it really even meant to be a girl. And I decided that I just wasn't. Like, I just couldn't be. Yeah. I think yeah. that I thought that I was a boy.
Uh-huh. How did you tell your parents that you thought you were a boy, and how did they take it?
I wanted to wait a little bit before telling them, just to like kind of get comfortable as I went through transitioning. The little baby steps, I started with socially transitioning. I decided between a few names, and I was starting to slowly develop a more masculine wardrobe and start to give away some of my girl clothes to like some of my friends or like some of my family in the Philippines. And I started cutting my hair shorter. I told some people at school about it. Most of them actually didn't take very well to it, and I was bullied for it. And then once I was ready to do that, I wrote a letter to them, because I saw somebody else do the same thing. And I thought it was a pretty smart idea, because I was very afraid of how they would react to this. I didn't know whether they would support me or see me as their son, or even be willing to try to accommodate me. And I understood that it was also kind of a big thing for them to learn. And I was just kind of intimidated by all of that. And I also wanted to give them some time to think over it, how they might respond to this. And so I wrote them a letter saying that I was their son and not their daughter, and that I chose a new name, and I hoped that they would still love and accept me the same way. And they did.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And looking back on it now, was telling your parents the crucial step for you going forward with some of the more medicalized aspects of transgenderism?
Yeah. Their first response was to start sending me to therapy, because like they were willing to like accommodate my preferred name and pronouns and stuff, but they were worried naturally about where this was coming from and why I wanted to be a boy, what was making me feel that way, and what made me think
right.
that I right. had to do this. Mm-hmm. And they saw it as a mental health issue, and I think they were right on that. But mm-hmm. I feel like if we just like sat down and had a conversation about it, they probably just would have figured that I didn't really need therapy for it. I would have just grown out of it. Like, it was just a phase, as cliche as it might sound, and that I was just a tomboy, maybe a little autistic, maybe I had my head in the clouds a lot of the time. But I mean, it was nothing too out of the ordinary. But they didn't really know anything about this at the time, because there wasn't really much information on it. Mm-hmm. And they never really heard anything like this from any of my older siblings. So this was totally new to them. And they thought like they might as well get the professionals to help them through this and to help me with it. So they got like a child psychologist through our healthcare provider. It kind of sucked, actually, that first therapist, because he didn't really do anything. Like, I would tell him about like what was going on at home or like internally or at school, and he was just like, oh yeah, that's kind of weird, okay. And then he wouldn't really like try to talk me through it or like how to cope with it. It was just like, I would talk about it, he wouldn't really say anything about it, and then we were done. But when it mm-hmm. came to like my gender dysphoria, like that was pretty much one of the first few questions that was asked, like, what do you identify as? Like, what's your legal name and your preferred name? And what pronouns do you want us to use for you and such? And I was getting frustrated because I kept having these appointments every week or every month or so, but like nothing would happen. And I started telling my parents, like, I'm not satisfied with this therapist. Like, nothing is happening. And I find myself becoming increasingly dysphoric because like I'm going back to school my 8th grade year and I'm presenting myself like a boy, but I still look like a girl. Like I have like a soft face and voice and stuff, and I don't really have like, I just don't look like the other boys my age, and I'm not seen as one of them because of that. And so I want to go on testosterone. That was the only choice that I knew of, because that was all the transgender community would talk about. It was presented as the only choice, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, nobody ever really talked about desistance or detransition, or even the fact that you can be gender dysphoric without choosing to transition.
Right.
I really right. truly thought that I was a boy.
Looking back on it, you're still dissatisfied with what he did and didn't do. What could he have done that would have been helpful, looking back on it from the perspective of a detransitioner? What could he have done that would have been helpful at that point?
I mean, if he taught me how to cope with like my struggles at school and at home and with my feelings, if he like went deeper into why I wanted to be a boy, what was making me feel like a boy, he would have determined that it was coming from my body image issues and just naturally being more tomboyish, having a more boyish personality, and that none of that was really out of the ordinary.
Gotcha.
I mean, I think a good therapist, a good psychologist would have just encouraged me to accept that these feelings were normal, very likely transient, that I would grow out of it, and just encourage me to express myself through other means that didn't require like medicalization.
And in retrospect, would it have been better if he had continued to call you Chloe and use female pronouns rather than to do what you had asked him to do? What do you think about that?
I mean, I would have been pretty upset about it for a while. Mm-hmm. But I think naturally over time, I would have just desisted, really.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So is there a way he could have presented that to you and said, you know, look, you're a girl, you're coming in here, you're a girl, you've got these issues, these things that we're going to talk about. You've asked me to call you by this name. You know, for the time being, at least, I'm going to continue to call you Chloe and use female pronouns. We'll get this straightened out. Would that have been okay for 12-year-old Chloe?
I would have been probably a little bit angry about it, but mm-hmm. over time, I would have just grown into it and accepted it.
By using the male pronouns, he was supporting the idea that it was possible for you to be a different person. But then he wasn't helping you. He wasn't helping you with that. He wasn't helping you with the coping. And it just you felt stymied then with that.
Yeah, I feel like in a way it kind of pushed me further into it just because I was so frustrated. And I kind of attributed that frustration to the inertia with my own transition.
I see. So tell us about the transition process. What finally, just tell us anything you want about how that started and how that went for you.
Yeah, eventually I was referred to another therapist because that guy was either fired by Kaiser or removed out of network for whatever reason, probably because he was pretty lousy. But eventually got diagnosed with gender dysphoria. And they did like a psychological screening and evaluation. They had on record that I was diagnosed with ADHD previously, and that I was kind of I had some symptoms of autism, that I struggled socially amongst my peers and at school, with organization and stuff, that I was more of a creative type, so I often was I was a bit of a dreamer. And that I had some symptoms of like social anxiety. But I also was a pretty happy kid. I wasn't all too that distressed, really, by my gender dysphoria or anything that was really happening in my life. Of course, I had some struggles, but I was getting through it. I was a pretty pleasant kid. But they totally perverted all of this. And at one point, my parents were really concerned as to why I wanted to go down this route so badly. And so naturally, again, they turned to the professionals who they thought they could trust. And they had an appointment with them. I believe I wasn't in the room for this just because I can't recall any of it. But my mom and dad asked, like, why I wanted this so badly. Why I would even need it at the age that I was, why I couldn't just wait until I was at least like legally an adult and I could like be responsible for my own self and make that decision on my own terms. And what the chances were that I would regret something like this, which were all pretty reasonable concerns. They told them that there was a reason why I wanted this so badly, and that even though I was a child, I knew exactly what I wanted, and that's why I was pushing for it so badly. It's not normal for kids to push for that so much, is it? Or so they thought. And they said that it was very unlikely that I would regret any of these procedures. I think the percentage they cited was about like 1 or 2%. And they said it was more likely that I would regret going through the motions of my natural puberty than I ever would going on these treatments, and that potentially this could make me suicidal. They were almost threatening my parents with the suicide of their own daughter. They said it was life or death, that they would likely either have a dead daughter or a living transgender son. And my parents, I mean, they were hooked after that. They were concerned for me. They loved me. They didn't want me to die, and they wanted to do what was best for me.
12-year-old Chloe is really insistent that Chloe wants to be a boy, and the gender specialists persuade your parents that this is the right thing. Is it safe to say that that's what happened there? Yeah, and so what was the first treatment that you received for that was gender dysphoria related?
The first treatment I went on was the puberty blockers, and the reason why they said it's kind of unusual because they didn't like cite the usual reasons for starting on them. Like most people say that puberty blockers are used to like in children, in gender dysphoric children, to just like delay or stop puberty temporarily, and then they can decide which one which puberty they want to go through, which is a ridiculous premise, right? I mean, once you start on pretty much any intervention, like the child is guaranteed to start transitioning. But my mom and dad and I were never told that. It was just like, oh, like since you're already so confident about doing this, well, we're just gonna start it just a month before you start on hormones, just so that you can like clear out the sex hormones from your body and make way for the exogenous hormones. So I was very, very much rushed. I mean, it was already established that I was going to go on hormones. And after my first puberty blocker shot was when I signed off the forms for testosterone. And after about like a month or so later was when I had my first testosterone shot.
You were 13. And what was that like? What was that first shot like?
I mean, when I was on puberty blockers, the effects didn't really come right away. until after about like 2 weeks later, when it because the steep drop in estrogen, it caused a period, and it was like a very heavy, very painful period, not quite like the ones that I had before, and it kind of sucked. And so once I started on testosterone, it was amazing. Like I, part of it was just like they call it the gender euphoria of being on these treatments and feeling affirmed, feeling confident, and looking forward to like the next, to the results, and that feeling of satisfaction with oneself. And I definitely felt that. I definitely saw it as a huge step in my life and towards becoming what I thought would be my greatest self as a boy and eventually a man. And the cognitive effects of it came pretty much right away. Like I had a big boost in my confidence overall. I started to become more competitive with my peers, and especially like my male peers. I had like a really steep increase in my libido.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think the first physical effects started to roll around like maybe like within a month, was when my voice started to drop. The increase in the deepness in my voice was really dramatic. My physical appearance started to change as well. I started to get thicker hair, thicker eyebrows, develop a little bit of facial hair, a little bit more body hair. I started developing more muscle. My fat redistributions were starting to change, so my body shape was starting to become less feminine, less like fat stored in the hips and thighs, and like more in my waist. And I started to look slowly and slowly, more so every day, like the boys my age. And it felt great that I was starting to become more like one of them.
And what was your first clue that things weren't going the way you wanted them to?
That wasn't until much later, after okay. I had the surgery.
I see.
I was very confident in my transition up until that point. By the time that I was in high school, I was on hormones long enough to that I pretty much passed as any other boy my age, really. I had a deeper voice than most of them, actually, because of the hormones. They were that powerful. And I guess I was just that lucky or unlucky, depending on how you see it. And I didn't really have to have a coming out or anything like that, because most people didn't even know that I was a biological female.
So this started towards the end of your eighth grade year. And by the time you started your ninth grade year, you were in a school that was big enough that you could have a peer group of people who hadn't known you in middle school. And even the people who had known you before didn't quite know you. You know, they didn't recognize you in the same way. Is that roughly the social situation?
And the ones who knew that I was, like, I tricked the eye so much that they naturally just went along with it.
I see. Everybody called you Leo. Everybody accepted that, and it was good. So at this point, you're happy with your transition. You got what you wanted. Okay. So at what point did you decide it was time to take another step?
It was about halfway through my sophomore year that I started telling my therapist that I wanted to go through the motions of surgery, because I'd been binding my chest for about 2 years by this point using a device called a binder. I didn't start doing it until one particular traumatizing event in my eighth grade year prompted me to start doing so. And that was when he sexually assaulted me. He walked up to me in the middle of a classroom that was crowded. There were other kids who could have seen and reported it, but they didn't. And I had so many feelings about what happened to me that were just too difficult for me to express. I mean, it was humiliating, not because like this part of my body, this very intimate part of me that I already don't like very much, has been compromised. And I wanted to protect myself, to shield myself from it happening ever again. He crossed that boundary. And I felt like I couldn't tell anybody about it because, well, I could tell my mom and dad. And they would have been very angry about it. They would have wanted to get the school involved with it. But if I did get the school involved, who knows how they would have reacted.
And that associated for you painful, traumatic feelings about this part of your body. And so now you're tormenting yourself in that part of your body.
Right.
Am I overstating that?
No, it's true. I didn't even have a chance at processing what happened to me because I was in the mindset of being a boy and I wanted to run away from it. And also because I didn't get any justice. I didn't get the help that I needed. And he got away with it.
Right, right. And you didn't, because you already didn't trust the school, and you and your parents had this history of trying to deal with your gender dysphoria, and you weren't sure, you didn't really know, okay, you're 12 years old, and you had something like this happen to you, you really didn't know what to do, so you kept it to yourself. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, honey, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry all that happened to you.
It kind of just stayed at the back of my mind. But
yes,
that fear of it happening again was there.
Yes. And that boy, he thought of you as a girl though at that point, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, everybody was thinking you were Chloe, you weren't Leo at that point. So yeah, he knew was he was doing something to a girl. Yeah, he was
doing
something.
Yeah, this was actually after I started hormones and transitioning socially and stuff. So everybody knew that I was I didn't necessarily come out to everybody, but everybody kind of knew intuitively that I wasn't really trying to be a girl. And
I see. So what put you on the path, or what made you decide that you wanted to do the surgery?
Yeah, that unresolved sexual trauma I didn't realize was a big part of my decision, or even around my feelings around my chest. But right. I was sick of wearing that stupid binder every day. For upwards of maybe 8 hours on average, because that's how long my school days were. And I would wear it whenever I went out, just because obviously I don't want to look like a boy and then have this part of my body very obviously femininely shaped, you know? And it was just, it got more and more uncomfortable. I got more and more uncomfortable with my body over time because my voice was deep, I looked like a boy, but I still had breasts.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so on one level, you're trying to rid yourself of a hated part of your body that has caused you problems for a long time from your description. And on the other hand, you want to fit in with the kids. And so how did the medical professionals help you or guide you at this particular point?
It was very, very quick. It was only about half a year between the first consultation with the surgeon and then actually going under the knife. It was that quick. And there wasn't really a whole lot of counseling during this time. They actually knew that my psychological state was starting to deteriorate by this time. My grades were dropping, I was becoming more depressed. They actually diagnosed me with major depressive disorder and started medicating me for it.
Wow.
And they just turned a blind eye to all of that. And I was allowed to go through it as I wanted.
Uh-huh. And what did your parents think about all this?
They were even more concerned this time, obviously. They brought it up to the doctors, and they were presented with the very same argument. Your child is going to commit suicide. Your child is going to die if you don't let her do this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, but at that point, were you suicidal at that point?
I think I was. I did experience suicidal ideation by this point. Mainly because I felt very, very lonely.
Yes.
My dysphoria was already being, at least initially, resolved by the treatments they were giving me. And in therapy, they would always ask, they'd always pivot to my gender dysphoria. The first thing they would always ask was, how is your gender dysphoria doing? I'm well into the process of transitioning. Everybody knows me as a boy. I don't really care about that anymore, because now
I see.
It's just a part of my life. But I think what made me want to not be here anymore was this deep loneliness. And part of it came from the fact that I had a very restricted dating pool now that I was transitioning. And it still felt like I was more of an object than anything.
Well, you know, a lot of young adult and teenage dating scene is using people using each other, people having a kind of commodified view of one another. So what you're experiencing right. there is not unique to a gender dysphoric.
But it's amplified.
Yes, I can see exactly how that would be. So there, you and your parents were being put, as soon as you said, I want the knife, they're like, yes, the doctors are like, yes. Now, when you did go under the knife, things began to change. Somewhere in there, what you expected and what you got really, really fell apart. Incongruence, right? It was no longer congruent between your expectations and what you actually got. So tell us what happened next, Chloe.
When I woke up from the surgery and like I was fully conscious, all the medication wore off and I recognized what just happened. I was ecstatic. I was so happy to finally have my breasts removed and be more like the boys. And yes. I was ready to go home, go through the healing process. And once like the scars and the skin grafts were fully healed, I'd be able to go out to the beach with no shirt on. I'd be able to swim with no shirt on. I don't have to wear a t-shirt anymore as I'm going on a run. And I can change in the locker rooms and just like hang out without worrying about what's underneath, you know? And the initial healing stages especially were pretty rough. I was recommended not to raise my arms above my head until about like 2 or 3 months in. So during like that initial week in the initial month, I had a very limited range in my upper body just because like it's a major surgery up there. I mean, they're removing entire organs.
So when did you start to feel like something wasn't right or this wasn't what you wanted or what it wasn't what you expected?
Well, the healing was, it was a little rough. So because they use skin grafts in my mastectomy, they took the areolas off, and grafted them into a more masculine positioning, they said, which I think is kind of ridiculous. But I was actually trying to push for a less invasive operation, which was one of the options they presented to me initially. And then when I started saying like, I want to go for the less invasive one where I can like maintain like sensation and maybe like the stalk of the nipple, they're like, oh no, there's a risk of losing the blood supply. It's experimental, even though the whole thing is experimental.
Right.
So I had to go with the most invasive, most common, and for the surgeon, the least expensive type of incision.
And were your parents required to give their permission to this, or was this on your, did you give the informed consent for this?
Yeah, I mean, they had a send off and everything, but like I said, it was under duress. I don't really truly believe that it was consent. It was coercion.
Right. But I'm just wondering, the way you're describing it, you said, I want this, and then they're steering you to something else. And, you know, you kind of, the whole family was getting steered.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. And so the recovery took longer because of the skin grafting. Was it successful?
The healing of the grafts is very, it's brutal. The areolas weren't pigmenting over fully, and the superficial skin on the very top was kind of dry and cracked. It seemed to be all right, but yeah. I've actually started to have some complications with them starting last year. And I was expected to fully heal by around like a year and a half around there. But out of nowhere, the skin grafts started to weep fluid every single day, nonstop. There's nothing I knew about it, aside from like getting bandages and covering them to prevent it from like getting on my shirts and my blankets and my bedding.
Right.
And this has been totally unexplained. I've tried to go back to my surgeon. He was totally brushing off my my concerns and just told me like just put some Vaseline on it, which didn't make sense because like his explanation for it was to keep the wound moist even though it was already weeping fluid.
Right.
I took his advice because it was like, well, it sounds weird, but I'm sure he's probably seen this before with another patient. So maybe that's why it's so normal to him. I did it and it gave me a skin infection and I haven't been able to go back to him because how could I trust him to help me?
Yes.
After he's done this to me, after he's refused to help me or get a physical appointment with me.
Yeah. And so it's safe to say that when you agreed to, when you went and sought a double mastectomy, that you did not expect that 4 years later, 3 years later, that you would still be having healing issues. And this is completely apart from the gender dysphoria issues. Just the physicality of this thing is more complicated than you were led to expect. Yeah.
I mean, I heard like it the healing process was going to be pretty nasty in some ways, but it was like, all right, like it's just part of the process. But you don't really understand just how it feels to go through it until you actually are. And the complication, most of the complications that I'm experiencing today were not listed on the forms for any of these treatments. Like for a while, I was having issues with my urinary tract because of the testosterone. Like I was getting UTIs like maybe like every other month. And sometimes I would get like clots of blood and then eventually like bits of tissue in my urine. And nobody figured it out. Nobody helped me. Like they just said like, oh, it's a UTI, take this supplement, go on antibiotics, or we're gonna like diagnose you over the phone with this condition that we don't know you have for sure because we haven't done a physical examination. Just totally unhelpful in every single way.
Right. And as you said, the whole thing is experimental. Right. And so, you know, they think they're doing they're affecting one little part of the body. And in fact, it's going through, it's systemic, right? You change your hormonal mix, it's affecting the whole body. And here you're having urinary tract problems as a result of the hormones. Wow.
But the thing that really started to make me question everything was the fact that I started to miss being pretty and looking feminine. And being able to like present myself femininely without judgment. Because now if I wanted to like have long hair or wear makeup at school, I was gonna like get called gay or something. I was gonna get made fun of. Sure. I was gonna get bullied for it. And like I started to realize like there's not really any way back, is there? And even as I tried to accept this and just kind of explain my sudden desire to be feminine again, which is like, well, I guess maybe I'm just experimenting. Maybe I'm just an effeminate male. Maybe I'm non-binary even, because it was just hard to accept that transition could have been wrong, because I was already so deep into it. I was like 2 or 3 years in. I'd been on hormones for some time. So like I had a super deep voice and like a very, very masculine face and body. And now my breasts are gone. So how am I going to go back?
Was there something in particular that brought to your mind, I wish I could have these feminine traits again. I wish I could nurse my baby. I wish I could nurse a baby. Can I even have a baby? What was it? Was there some particular trigger for that whole line of thought, Chloe?
I kept going down this downward spiral for months and not really understanding why and trying to keep justifying it, going in circles in my head. Until in about the last month of my junior year, in a psychology class I was taking, towards the very end of it, it was focused on like children, adolescents, and parenting, and like the complexities that go into raising a child. And there was one lesson that was on like experiments on the infants of rhesus monkeys, the Harlow experiments involving the cloth mother versus the wire mother, and like the focus on like maternity and breastfeeding and physical affection between a mother and her infant just kind of blew my mind. Like, I didn't know about a single part of this before.
Right.
And I'm the youngest right. child. I've never had to, like, I don't really have, like, any little cousins or anything, so I've never had, like, babysit or, like, I guess, like, practice any sort of maternal instinct. And this was when I realized, I want to do that. I want to have kids.
Oh, honey. Wow.
Well, I'm on hormones. I've been on hormones for a while. I don't know if I'll be able to naturally like give birth and have biological children, but the fact that like I'm missing out and I'll never even have a chance at this thing that I didn't realize was so special, that the adults made no effort to inform me about the importance of, that's gone forever. And it was hard to live with that realization. And it was just a little while afterward, after like weeks of not really being able to do anything, of like crying on end, I realized I couldn't do it anymore. I regretted my transition. I was gonna take the final testosterone shot, and I was never gonna do it again. What life would look like from there, I had no idea, but I kind of knew what direction I wanted to go in. I was gonna start embracing my femininity again. I was gonna grow out my hair. I was gonna buy new girls' clothing and put my old boys' clothing in boxes. And eventually I came to accept myself as a girl again. And I stopped using all the he, they pronouns and just accepted that that's the way I was made. And it took a little while for me to decide to go back to my birth name, just because like for the longest time I felt like the name Chloe didn't really fit me. I thought it was too girly, too cheery. I didn't think that was me. And I really liked the name that I chose for myself. It's a pretty cool name, but I realized like my birth name was a gift. Like my mom and dad chose it for a reason, and they gave it to me because they loved me. You know, so I kind of felt like I had a responsibility to go back.
Yes, yes. Oh, honey, that's beautiful. That's really beautiful that you said. You know, Chloe, this is a miraculous story. I haven't asked you anything about faith and whether your family has any religion or any faith background or anything like that. But I'm going to just tell you, to me, this sounds miraculous. You know, that the power of motherhood just kind of swooped into your life. And all of a sudden you realize that being female is a gift. And you know, one would say it's a gift from our creator. It's a gift from God. You were created as a woman. This is a power that you were given by God. And all of a sudden, it's like at the age of 16, you finally realize that it's the beauty of the thing. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's exactly how I feel.
Yeah, yeah. That's so amazing. So are you at peace with that aspect of things now? I mean, have you kind of come to terms with the fact that you don't know what your fertility is going to be? You know, you're never going to nurse, but you don't know what your fertility is going to be, but motherhood is still something that's important to you. Are you at peace with that, Chloe?
Yeah. I mean, I very much want to have kids of my own and hopefully I can have biological children, but I mean, I wouldn't mind adopting or maybe even having mixed like adopted and biological children, if that's a possibility.
Right.
But it was a very, the pain of realizing it. I mean, in spite of how difficult it was very necessary to get me to this point.
Right, right. It was a wake-up call. It was a facing reality moment for you. Yeah. And there's been a lot of unreality, it sounds like, around the issues. So this was the moment that, in spite of all the physical problems that you had as a result of the attempt to transition, there was also a moment when you saw that the gender dysphoria issue wasn't what it seemed to be, somehow that your way of thinking about that had been incomplete or mistaken in some way. Is that fair to say?
By that point in time, I was so far removed from like any dysphoria, really.
Really?
Just like the pain of my body and the changes that had been made to it and the years that I had lost of female development just like just kind of kicked in whatever feelings of dysphoria I even had left to the curb. And there were times when like sometimes it would sporadically come back, but I mean, I find that like just being at peace with what I have, the fact that I'm a woman, that I was made this way for a reason, and that's a good thing.
Yes.
Just living with reality was the thing that ultimately really got me out of it.
Yes. Yes. And reality can be a bitch, but the alternative is actually worse. Right? These things we invent for ourselves are, oh my gosh, we cause so much problems for ourselves. And yeah. So I don't know if you want to go here. I know you're in the process of doing some type of lawsuit with Kaiser. I don't know if you feel inclined to say anything about that.
I knew from like the very beginning of my transition that I wanted to get justice, that what happened to me was incredibly cruel and should not ever happen to a kid, especially under these circumstances. I mean, it was medical malpractice. It was fraud. They lied to my mom and dad. And I don't want to live in a world where those doctors did that to me and probably dozens of other kids and get away with it. My first testimony in Louisiana and Ohio, Harmeet Dhillon from Center for American Liberty reached out to me. How could I not take up this opportunity? Like, I was so grateful that I was able to have an opportunity like this, and I'm really looking forward to how it's going to turn out.
Yes. Well, a lot of us are, you know, to be honest, Chloe, a lot of us are. A lot of us feel what you feel, you know, obviously not as intensively, but, you know, we look at it and go, how is this possible? How is this possible that people could be treated in such a, you know, anti-scientific, inhuman, really it's inhuman to me, you know,
really,
and I'm nowhere near it. I'm not, you know, I'm just looking at it from the outside. It's like, this makes no sense. I want to ask you, and I don't know if you'll feel compromised if I ask you this question, looking back on it and with all that you know now, what do you think those doctors were really thinking? What do you think is their motive?
See, I think there's three different kinds of doctors that, perform these treatments. The first and most obvious one would be the doctors who are doing it for political or social gain, to like gain power in like their medical circles and be hailed as some sort of hero for helping children and adults through their gender dysphoria and guiding them through their gender journey. And then there's the ones who are just like, who I think are equally evil, really. The ones who are complacent and just going along with what they're told, just going along with the protocol. And then there's the other one, which, I mean, I think there are some doctors out there who really truly believe that they are helping the patients through this by giving them just what they want. And this is how they've been trained, this is how they've been taught to take care of their other patients with gender dysphoria, and that this really is the only option they have, and to do anything else is cruel. And I think I probably had all three of those.
Mm-hmm. So the last type you could call the true believers, that they really believe that what they're doing is right. And then you've got the people who are just going along to get along.
Yep.
And then the first type that you mentioned are people who, whether they're true believers themselves or not, they are aware that this is the path for medical advancement and social advancement, and that's their principal motive. Is that what you're telling me?
Yes.
That's what you think is true? Yeah. And you feel like you encountered all three of those types?
Yeah, I probably did.
Yeah. Okay. Is there anything you'd like to say about faith and your family's faith experience or religion? Is that a factor in your guys' life?
I do consider myself to be a believer. I do consider myself a Christian. I don't really associate with a particular denomination. But my dad was raised in a Mormon household, and my mom, I believe, was Catholic or something similar, just because like she's Filipino. A lot of Filipinos are Catholic. But... Yeah. growing up, like, I went to church up until I was about like 4 years old, and I haven't really talked to my parents about why they stopped taking me. I think part of it was like that was like around like 2008, 2009 when the recession hit. And I think my dad just became more busy. He was like in and out of jobs for some time and working a lot of time. So he didn't really have as much time to spend with family. I feel like my parents also just wanted to, they didn't want to feel like they were forcing any sort of belief on me and kind of just allow me to organically develop beliefs of my own. But in a way, it made it so that I didn't really have much structure in terms of like a system of beliefs or values. And I feel like that was kind of a big part of why I struggled with my identity so much.
And it's not like your parents were bad people or anything like that. They had a moral code and your family had a moral code and the behavior that was expected and stuff like that. A lot of families would fit your description approximately. Let's put it that way. Parents are raised in some kind of faith. Nobody really practices the faith. The kids are kind of on their own. Yeah. Is there anything you'd like to say in closing to the Ruth Institute followers?
Well, I think that was a pretty good interview. I think it was pretty comprehensive. I got everything out that I wanted to. I guess, like, if you want to hear more from me, or if you want to, like, follow, like, my content or what I'm doing, I'm active on Twitter, which I guess they're now renaming to X, Instagram, and YouTube, all under the same username, C-H-O-O-O-C-O-L-E. That's three O's in the middle there. Or you could just find me by looking up Chloe Cole. And I'm actually doing an interview series of other detransitioners as I'm on my travels. So.
Oh, wonderful. That will be really wonderful. We'll be very interested. I know people are going to be really interested in that. And I'm sure people will be very blessed by those interviews. So Chloe, I just want to thank you so much for being my guest today on today's episode of the Dr. J Show. I have no doubt that this is going to be a very popular episode and that people are really going to be blessed by what you've had to say. And I really appreciate your maturity and your candor and your willingness to speak out about this issue. It can't have been an easy journey, but I what I sense about you is that you're at peace. Is that right?
I mean, I'm still going through the motions, but I'm getting there, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And that's really the goal in a way, you know, rather than I'm going to accomplish this thing. You want to be at peace in your life, you know, so.
And it doesn't happen right away.
No, it does not for any of us, no matter what our journey is. That's always an ongoing struggle. So I want to just thank you so very, very much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
And thank you for having me.